I got frostbitten in the winter.
Let's roll. I want to ask you about the origin of your amazing name, first of all. Do you know about the history of the Ruffell?
No, not really. I assume it's French.
Right. It's a great showbiz name. I'm assuming it's your birth name.
Yeah, it's my real name.
So no changes needed there.
No, people say that to me, but I never realised it was sort of a good stage name.
Yeah, it's a great stage name.
Yeah, I guess so. It just never really, it's just when it's your own name.
Yeah, you don't
anything.
Look at it that way.
Okay, my dad's name is better. My dad's called Roly Ruffell.
Really? Roly?
Roly.
Incredible.
Yeah, Roly Ruffell.
Short for Roland.
No, Roy. Long for Roy.
Right.
Doesn't really make any sense.
Long for Roy. Yeah. You grew up in Portsmouth, which is where a good friend of mine is from, Stephen Hill. I don't know whether you know him. He used to dabble in stand-up for a couple of years, about 10 years ago. But he talks very, very fondly of old Pompey. Did you have a good time growing up there?
There's things about it that I like and things I don't like. When I was growing up there, I found it to be... I think it can be a little bit inward-looking.
Uh-huh.
Politically, I'm not really on board with a lot of...
Is it a bit of a Brexit stronghold, is it?
Yeah. Yeah, quite conservative.
Right.
But, like, working-class conservative.
Uh-huh. Flags hanging out of windows, that kind of thing?
In some areas.
Yeah.
which isn't my vibe.
No.
But, yeah, it's all right. It's like anywhere. There's good and bad. There's parts of it that are lovely. You know, the seafront and the beach, really nice. And there's really lovely parts of it. And then there are really rough parts of it that you don't want to get
to.
There
are there?
Yeah.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So when you were growing up, were you like a happy kid? Did you have a lot of like friends?
No, I was a bit of a kid. When I was like at primary school, I was pretty good, had like mates and everything was pretty fine.
Did you enjoy school itself?
No, Mum said that she took me and afterwards I said... took me on the first day and I went for a couple of days and then afterwards I was like, yeah, I'm not going to do that anymore.
She's like, you kind of have to.
Oh, yeah, you have to for like, you know,
the next
15
decade.
Years. Yeah, exactly. 13 years. So, I wasn't a massive fan of school. Certainly secondary school I hated.
Really?
Yeah, I didn't get on. I didn't like the school. I didn't like the teachers.
It's amazing that clip... you know, the famous viral one of yours has done something mad, like 21 million views.
Yeah, it's
views
really weird.
Now.
Yeah. And it's just a true story about me in being a pain in the ass at
and
school.
And thank God for your dad, because he kind of makes
my
the punchline, doesn't he?
My dad makes the punchline, which he does, you know, which he's lent me a punchline or two over the years. But yeah, that clip, there's a couple of clips from, that's from like a special I did from the BBC, for the BBC rather. And that's, there's a few clips. One of them's on like 11 million. That one's on 20-something million. It's sort of weird.
21 as of today, I saw.
Was it?
Yeah,
that's mad. Because when it was like at 1 million, I was like texting my agent, like, this clip's got to a million. That's
mad. Fully stoked. And then now, the numbers become so big that it's unfathomable, isn't it? You can't even wrap your head around it.
I don't know what that means. Yeah, and like there's so many comments, which I'm like, obviously I'm not going to start looking at them because that's where like madness lies.
Right.
But
does stuff like that boost your career in the way that you think that it would? Because we very much live in this bite-sized content world now, right? Where the slightest little thing can go completely viral. But then I do wonder if it does have a return. Like, are a large percentage of those 21 million would be a less viral
sadder.
Video.
Yeah, that'd be a much...
Are they then coming to your shows, buying tickets, following you online? Like, do you see a notable surge after something like that?
I think that the Facebook views and clips... Because the people that sort of my agency, very clever with all that sort of thing. And so there's always like a link to buy tickets.
Yeah.
And so it's about sort of streamlining an audience. How many of those people watch a clip and then buy tickets? I don't know. But I always try and keep my ticket prices pretty low so that I'm never pricing people out. So it feels like my last tour was like 12 quid for a 2-hour long show with support, you know, like it's proper night out. And I'm not sure. I think... I mean, I think once upon a time, you know, you do like Live at the Apollo, and obviously this predates a lot of like the internet clip stuff, but you do Live at the Apollo, and you know,
it's a clear stepping stone.
Millions and millions would watch it live, you know, not that it's shot live, but I mean, when it goes out on the time that it goes out, obviously catch up and stuff didn't exist other than when you do it with your own VHS. And then there would be like massive spikes in their ticket sales. Like I know comedians who are, you know, 10, 15 years older than me or longer in the game than me, let's say, who did their Apollos then, you know, it would have, you know, their tour would then sell out.
Yeah.
You could sell a whole tour, you know, a 50, 60 date tour just off of doing Live at the Apollo, which is what, like an 8 minute set. Whereas now you've got to be so like Apollo, Mock the Week, 8 out of 10 Cats.
Omnipresent.
The Dave shows, you know, like all of the different things you've got to be like, and then you've got to be online. And are you on Twitter? And are you funny on Twitter? And what's happening on your Instagram? And are you funny on Instagram? And what are you selling? And what's your thing? And who are you trying to, and it is a bit, like, there's some people that are really good at it. There's some people that are a bit cringe at it. And you've sort of got to find that level of being, you know, I'm trying to be funny because I'm trying to sell you tickets to my show. But at the same time,
not being too grabby.
Yeah, it's really hard because I think as a comic, and certainly the sort of stand-up that I do, it's really conversational. It's like I'm sort of friendly and I'm not, I don't know, I'm not trying to like beat you over the head with.
Yeah, and you're not like above the audience.
No, no way.
Like a Jimmy Carr type, who I love, but he's very much like,
oh, no, no, no.
I'm not one of you.
Yeah, no, I'm very much, I mean, I'm, and like the reason I sort of love doing my tour shows and the reason that it's such a joy to tour is that my audience is hugely diverse. And I like to think that anyone can come to my tour show and have a brilliant night and no one's ever picked on. And like, I'm always the biggest joke in the room. Everything always comes down to me or something I've done. And that's the sort of stand-up that I like. That's the sort of stand-up that I'm inspired by. And there are loads of other types of stand-ups that exist. And, you know, all of them are valid and all of them have their place. But for me, that's the sort of stuff I like.
Who were your heroes and inspirations early on?
Alan Carr would definitely be one. I have watched Tooth Fairy more than any other DVD. That's his debut DVD, which I just loved.
And you did a big tour with him.
I did, Jerry. Right? I opened for him on tour, which was amazing because I was a massive fan of his before I was a stand-up. So it was a huge thing to be asked to then go on the road with him, which was lovely.
Was that one of the first big ones that you did, or had you done a couple that point?
I'd done sort of Josh Widdicombe by that point, maybe a few dates with Ramesh Ranganathan, but they weren't as big as they are now. So sort of I started supporting Josh during his first tour. So the first date that we did together was maybe like 120 people, whereas now, you know, I'm doing some of Josh's upcoming tour and it'll be 1,500, like 2,000. So but that's just because we're really good mates and we like going on the road together.
Yeah,
and
it's really
fun.
I saw a comment on YouTube actually, which was hilarious. And it said, Suzi is like a female Josh Widdicombe. And I was like, what does that even mean?
I don't, Also, I'm not because Josh, Josh and I think, are in complete separate columns of stand-up. So I'm someone, I look inwardly and tell you about how I'm feeling. Josh looks outwardly and tells you what the world looks like for him.
Yeah.
So we couldn't be more different, but I think I've done a lot with Josh and always like, and I've done quite a bit of telly with him and 3 or 4 shows on TV with him. And then I've done hundreds of shows with him on the road. But, you know, I like being compared to Josh. I love him. But back to your earlier question of comedians that inspired me. I mean, I think that there's just so many. I mean, really, Alan was sort of before I'd even started stand-up. And I'd seen Lee Evans when I was a teenager. And I just remember thinking, how is this small man making thousands of people laugh? It was completely, I thought it was the cleverest thing I'd ever seen. And I you know, I still think stand-ups, you know, when someone gets it really right, I think it's incredible.
It's a powerful experience. It must be commanding a room in that way without any backing or support, just
really
your raw soul personality.
Well, that's why it's so, I mean, that's why it's so, doing it is so amazing, and that is why the stakes are so high, because when it's amazing, it's incredible. Like, you know, I did Live at the Apollo last year. It's probably my favorite gig of the year. It was, obviously, it's packed. It's Live at the Apollo.
Yeah.
3,500 people. I was on with Kerry Godleyman, who's a really good friend of mine. She was hosting the show. So I had been with her all day. Felicity Ward was on the early show, another really good friend of mine. So it felt like a really fun day where I was with people that I really liked. I didn't have too much time in my dressing room by myself to get nervous.
So you're distracted from the
distracted.
Pressure.
I knew the makeup ladies because they'd done my makeup before for other TV shows. So there was all, everything was, it just felt fun. I was having a laugh all day. And then I had this sort of dreamy gig, which was just amazing. And when you hear 3,500 people laugh all at the same time, and they're lit when you do Live at the Apollo as well. So normally when you're in a comedy club, it's very dark.
Is that just so they can get the reactions for TV?
Yeah, of course. Yeah, exactly. So so you can see them.
Yeah.
So you know if you're not having a great time. And people had warned me of that. Like, you know, there might be people that like get up and go to the toilet, or there might be people that move around.
Are they a paying audience, or are they there as...
No, they're like...
competition winners, sort of.
No. It's like SRO, the people that like give out free tickets for all TV shows. So no one ever pays to watch telly being recorded. You've just got to like sign up on a list and queue from really early and you get in. But I could see my girlfriend, which was really weird.
And she
was like, I don't know, like... She wasn't in the first bank of seats. She was behind like the little walkway area, and there's a new bank of seats, and she wasn't even in the first couple of rows of that. So I was like, you can really see everyone, and you know, the reaction was great, and I, you know, the wind was blowing in my favour that night, and I had a really special gig. And when you make that many people laugh at the same time, it's like magic. And I love it, and I think that's why. You know, I'm doing lots of other bits and pieces, and I've always had an interest in doing stuff outside of stand-up, but I don't think I could ever move that far away from stand-up because I just love it.
Because of the addiction to the...
Yeah, and it's just, it's like nothing else. Like, so today, I've been working on my new show, which I'm taking up to Edinburgh. I've been writing it all day. I've been trying to work out this new part of the show. I think I might have cracked it today. I'm going to go and try it tonight, and I'll know whether I was right by 9 o'clock. And there's very few jobs that are like that. If you're a musician, you have to put the sound all together, and you've got to get the band together. And unless you're someone that's like, you know, gigging about as a musician, but you know, just to go, oh, I wrote that today, and I'm going to find out if it works tonight. There's nothing quite as quick as that.
Immediacy of the reaction as well, right?
Yeah.
And also, you're the writer, the director, the performer.
Yeah.
You're every element of the end product.
Yeah. When I do, I have a director for like. A little for my Edinburgh shows for like the last maybe month and a half. She's my friend Rose Johnson, who's like a really great actress and sketch performer as well, and she does a bit of stand-up as well, and she's brilliant. And she basically just to have another eye.
Because
you've got that pressure,
well, you're so in it, aren't you? It can be hard sometimes to be objective.
Sometimes it's hard to, you will think you've told the audience something, and she'll be like, you didn't mention that. I'd be like, I'm sure I didn't. She'll be like, you didn't.
Is adrenaline a part of that?
Yeah,
because you're
I
in
guess
that buzz,
so.
Buzz
yeah,
zone.
Yeah, I think so. And it's, you know, it is the riding of the waves, and sometimes it's nice to have. And a lot of people have that for their Edinburgh shows or for their tour shows. They'll have a director just to get another pair of eyes on it. Because you're absolutely right. Like, I write all my own stuff, and obviously I'm the only one up there. And you know, the pressure's huge to get it right. And it means that when you smash it, it's amazing because you're like, look at what I've done. When you die on your ass, it's awful because you're like, look what I've done.
Well, I was going to ask you on the flip side, is that the most devastating of feelings, or do you kind of take those losses as part of the experience and build on them? And
I mean, it's never nice. Anyone, like, there are people that are like, oh, you know, I bombed
and it's fine.
I can die with grace. I mean, it's awful having a bad gig. It's awful. It's dreadful. And, like, you know, I've had shows in Edinburgh. Obviously not every night, but you have, like, bad nights in Edinburgh. You do 26 nights on the bounce. You're bound to have a handful that are tricky, most that are good, a handful that are amazing, and one or two...
stinkers.
...that hurt, that make you blush.
Do you ever doubt yourself to such a point where you consider... throwing in the towel with a bad show? Has there ever been moments like that for you?
No, not after one bad show, but there certainly was a phase where I thought, I'm not sure if I'm good enough for this. So basically, my biggest fear was being sort of mediocre and getting to a level of like, good enough. Yeah. Always 3 stars. That's what she is. And
plateauing, kind of.
Yeah, and I just... with stand-up, and I'm sure it's so similar for like the actors and the musicians you've interviewed as well, like, you really give your whole life to it. So for 10 years, I've not done much, but eat, sleep and breathe comedy.
Well, you miss out on weddings, yep, christenings, yep, birthdays, yep, events, holidays, yep, so much stuff like that. Yeah, because you're broke, right, for so long.
Yep. And last year, my girlfriend and I went to Spain for a week and I had to fly home for 2 days of filming. Like, it, yeah, just takes over your life.
It takes
and
its toll on relationships, doesn't,
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Luckily, my girlfriend is amazingly supportive and brilliant, and she totally gets it. But there are other relationships that have failed, and I think a lot of them are to do with the hours that you keep and the fact that it becomes all-encompassing. And I think it sort of needs to, certainly in the early days. Now I can have, you know, days off and I can have a bit of space from it. But certainly when you're, you know, one of, you know, 15 open spots that want to get on the bill tonight, and there's only 8 spots, you've got to turn up early and you've got to wait until 11 and you've got to get your 5-minute set. And, you know, everyone does that. I did a couple of Edinburgh shows. They both were fine. Not that interesting. No one was blown away by them. No one tore them apart. That was sort of where I was at. I did a tour with Romesh. Rom was killing it every night. I was having good enough gigs, but nothing exciting. And after that, I sort of thought, oh, I'm not sure that I'm ever going to be as good as Romesh or Josh. And I'm not sure if I have the tenacity or the skill to carry on doing it. And I thought then that was in probably like 2014. Yeah, about 2014, 2015, where I thought, do you know what? I'm not sure that I can keep on doing this because it's taking over every part of my life. And as you say, like, I'm missing out on other parts of my life. And I don't want to do all of that to be someone that's on the circuit for the rest of their life. And there's nothing wrong with being on the circuit. Circuit gigs are amazing. I've loved circuit gigs. You know, there's clubs that I still love playing.
But it's hardcore, isn't it?
Yeah, and I know that, like, you know, at some point I want to become a mother, and at some point, you know, I want to have a family and settle down. And I just knew that sort of road life, I don't, you know, I'm quite happy doing it now. And I love doing it for the tour, and it's slightly different when you're on the road bits because you're doing your own thing rather than being part of a mixed bill.
Yeah.
But I just knew that sort of wasn't what I wanted, because I know that I want all those other things in my life, and I knew that I didn't want to be, you know, 45 and still obsessed with stand-up. You know, I think I'll be obsessed with it to a degree, but I knew that wasn't what I really wanted. And so I thought, I'll write another Edinburgh show. I'll try and be a bit more honest. I'll try and talk about something I haven't talked about before, which was sort of my working class heritage, which is never really something that I'd sort of hinted at on stage, but I'd never really dissected. And then in, I think 2017, no, it must be, must be 2016, that's right, I took up a show called Common, and all of a sudden there was a shift. And
is that, do you think, because you were opening up and revealing, yeah, more of yourself?
Yeah, I think so. And I think I was just more experienced as a stand-up. Some people start and they're great at the beginning. I was someone that was great at performing. My writing wasn't amazing. And there were bits of it that was good at, but I could do all the voices. I could do little act outs. I could do all that fun side of it. But I wasn't so good at sitting down and really doing the work on the writing. And I think that's because it intimidated me. I'm really dyslexic. I didn't go to university. You know, prior to becoming a stand-up, the last time I had sat and written anything down was probably for my GCSEs.
Really? Wow.
So it's not I'd ever had to write, you know, I certainly never had to write a
dissertations
essay.
Yeah,
never.
Like,
and so the whole idea of writing or being a writer felt like, no, I'm a performer. I'm a performer. That's what I do. I perform. And it was a really long journey for me to be able to think, oh no, I can, I am a writer as well, and I'm good enough to be, considered to be a writer. But and so I think that when I started really talking about things that I genuinely feel, rather than like doing an impression of what a comedian was, which I think my first couple of shows were,
or more broad observational stuff,
and when I was sort of looking more inward was when I sort of first started to have my sort of, people started to take a bit of notice, people were a bit more interested, people started to give a shit a bit more.
Do you find that there are less working class comedians now than there were when you started, or
I'm not really sure. I mean, it's really hard. I can't work out if I'm still working class, because I've just bought a flat and with my girlfriend helped to buy, so it's not like I've got loads of money, but I have managed to get on the property ladder. You know, I'm from my mum and dad own their house, you know, not outright, they've got a mortgage, but they certainly both grew up in very, you know, very working class environment.
Grafted.
My dad, yeah, my dad really, and still now, my dad's a real grafter. He's 65. There's no chance he's going to be stopping working anytime soon.
He's not retired, no.
No. Because he works for himself. He sells lorries. If he stops selling lorries, he hasn't got, you know, other than a state pension, there's no money. And so
that's my fear of old age. I'm only 33, but I'm terrified.
Oh, I'm the same age. I'm the same. Yeah.
There's no pension plan.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's exactly how I feel.
You've got to work now, haven't you?
Yeah, exactly. That's exactly how I feel. But yeah, I think the thing with being working class, being a comedian, the thing that makes it hard is that, and I also got to say, I was really lucky because I am from a very sort of working class family, but if I couldn't pay my rent, my dad would always help me. You know, even if it hurt them, they'd help me. You know, so I'm very lucky in that respect, and I know that. But the reason is there'll be fewer working class people at the fringe because it's so expensive to go.
And so it's almost impossible for people of a certain economic position
to
be able
to
afford the full month.
So you do the full month. Yep. To give you an idea, last year I was in a 60-seater room in Edinburgh. I sold out every single night. I put on two extra shows in bigger rooms, in 100-seaters. Every ticket was gone for the whole of the run. I still came away £1,000 down.
Was it a lavish production?
No.
No. It's just because of the cost of being in Edinburgh for that month and
being
accommodation.
For that month, you've got to
pay whatever rent you're paying back home.
And pay a rent up here. You've got to pay rent on the room. You've got to pay for a tech. You've
got to pay
for the flyers, the poster, the photo design.
So they charge every performer for their room by the hour, do they all
mm-hmm.
work? Yeah. Wow.
And so it's, and that's the best I've ever done at the fringe. £1,000 down. You're like, that is
financially, that's the best you've ever done.
Yeah. And my agency are notorious for not, like, my agency, I don't pay them to produce me, and like, they're not they're really upfront. They don't take the piss with us. They're really fair, you know, where there are other agencies that, you know, you pay them a huge amount of money for them to produce you as well. So there's people, I've got friends that have come away from Edinburgh after having a good run, £8,000 down. It's mad. But it's like,
if you do it and it's successful, are you a lot more guaranteed to then?
Yeah, you get stuff like, you know,
go
like
on telly. And so it's almost an essential stepping stone in.
Well,
the
I guess it's like funding your own EP or something.
Yep.
Or, you know, or when people put out their own, you know.
But I guess the difference, if you fund your own EP, there's no guarantee it's going to get put on the radio.
No.
But does something like an Edinburgh experience massively increase your chances of
television
spots?
No, because
there'll be opening spots on live tours.
Opening spots on live tours, maybe. But there'll be, like, hundreds upon hundreds of comics that go up to the fringe this year. And they'll get very little out of it, other than becoming a better comic. And that's the thing. I mean, I think that the fringe is changing. There are venues that are doing it differently now, and that that are maybe a bit fairer in how they do it. But it's really difficult because you've got to be up there selling your wares for people to see you, for me to get more work for next year. So it's like this constant.
Is there a fear that if you don't go up there, you're going to miss out as well? Do you
like,
get
I
that
think,
kind of?
I think this year I probably could have not gone because I've got enough sort of telly and bits and bobs in the diary to keep me busy, but I wanted a new show to tour, and the best way to kick it into shape to do a nationwide tour is to do a month in Edinburgh.
Yeah,
because it'll be like, it'll go up and it'll be pretty tight and it'll be funny all the way through, it'll be pretty tight. By the end of the month, there won't be a beat out, and that's where you want to take around the country. That was like the last tour that I did was so much fun, the best one I've ever had, great audiences. Like,
what was the last tour called? Keep It Classy. Was that the
no
last
that
one?
Was the previous one. The last one was called Nocturnal,
right?
And it was so fun. I loved it so much. Every audience were brilliant, and it was because the show was so tight, and if I chatted to someone, I knew exactly how to get back into it, because it was like, I don't know, it was like in my bones. It was in,
yeah,
like,
yeah,
you know,
yeah.
I just knew it so well. Whereas when you first go up to Edinburgh, you're like, what is the next bit? What's the next bit? What's the next bit? You're saying other words and your brain's
Do you ever
going,
have like placement cards on the stage or anything like that where you've got visual cues?
I've hid them before.
You have?
Yeah.
I've noticed that Stuart Lee always has like just scribbles on his hand.
Yeah, a lot of people use their hands. I can't use my hands because I touch my face so much.
Yeah.
Then I end up with ink
smudged all down you.
Yeah. But I have in the past hidden things on the back of amps and stuff.
Because Steven Tyler from Aerosmith has these, but obviously they've got all the money in the world.
Yeah.
He has these screens that are invisible from the front of the room, but they're literally like teleprompters on the stage.
Oh, I've seen those. Not with him, but I've seen those the invisible teleprompters. Yeah. People use them at like the BAFTAs and stuff. I mean,
what's the actual experience of Edinburgh like from a personal growth point of view? Like, do you get to bond and hang out and spend a lot of time with comedians up there? Is it a fun social event, or are you all so busy working and you obviously don't want to go out and party because then the show's going to suffer?
It's like, a mixture of
is it a bit of a rock and roll chaotic?
I think it is for some people.
Yeah?
No, I think I'm a bit boring.
Right.
Because
professional. Suzi, professional.
Yeah, and like, I've got some comedy mates, like who I'm living with this year, Rosie Jones, Jenny Bead, both brilliant, both really good friends. I've got a bunch of friends up there this year, actually, that I really, really love, that would be really great to hang out with. But, you know, I don't feel the need to go out every night. I've got friends in London, like I've got my friends who are non-comedy people or who are comedy people that won't be at the Fringe. There'll be a few nights where I'll go out, but then if you get drunk, you feel hungover the next day.
Yeah.
You don't feel as good a day.
Is there anything worse than doing stand-up hungover? I imagine it would be pretty punishing.
Yeah, pretty punishing, yeah, especially because I'm really physical. It's not like I just put the mic in the stand and talk.
Yeah.
I'm like running about all over the place. And so like, it's, it is a bit of a trade fair, and it is, and I know that other comedians have said to me before in Edinburgh, God, you're boring here.
Really?
Yeah, but I
not
just...
Not on the stage, hopefully.
No, not on stage, but I just think, oh, it's so expensive to go, and I put, you know, if you've got a great audience and you're not great that night, then it's really your fault.
Yeah.
And I also think, you know, there's, you know, people don't have loads of money, and if people are paying 12 quid to come and see you, you
want to give them the best, yeah.
Yeah, you've got to bring it. And I think that it's... Yeah, I think it's a bit of a piss take if you're like... You know, I certainly made errors. I went on stage drunk when I was very new. I made a real tit of myself and really learnt my lesson.
Was that out of a nervousness and a Dutch courage?
No,
or was it just one night you...
I forgot that I had a gig and was doing Alan Carr.
That'll do it. He seems like he enjoys a drink. Does he do that on the road and still deliver? Because he's always getting pissed on his TV show.
Yeah, no, I mean, he's very professional on the road.
Right.
He's really...
I guess TV
really
for someone like that is more just like a busman's holiday, right?
Yeah, I also think that he's probably not drinking half as much as the guests. You know, he's still reading the autocue, right? He's probably being quite behaved.
I love Alan Carr. What a man. Mm. So when you
brilliant
moved to
guy.
London, when you initially moved to London,
yeah.
Are you... At home right away? Is it a daunting new scenario? Is it an eye-opening new environment? Because coming from somewhere like Portsmouth to London, at what age was it? At 18?
Yeah, I was at 18. I came up to go to drama school, which I loved. It was everything I wanted it to be. It was so exciting. It was, you know, it was moving away to the big city. I loved it. I mean, I lived in a really rough flat in Tooting. Like, retrospectively, I'm like, why did I love it? We didn't have a... They made one of the living room... They made the living room a bedroom. So our living room became, like, this hall area. Like, the landlord took the absolute piss. What a git. Like, taking
just
money
how
off
people
students.
Can we pile in
yeah,
there,
exactly.
Yeah.
And, I mean, I'll tell you what dates it. My rent was £360 a month. That'll date it. In Tooting... But I just loved it. Or I was surrounded by people that were into theatre, like I was and I still am, and into acting and into, and were a bit different and a bit quirky like me. And it was probably I'd had experiences when I'd been in like drama clubs and things as a kid, but it was the first time. I remember after like a term, driving home and just feeling like, oh, there's people like me.
Like
just
you found your place in the world almost.
Yeah, yeah. And just going home for Christmas and having a lovely time, but couldn't wait to get back. And I just loved it. And I still love London. Like Portsmouth is home because that's where my family are. And I, you know, I'm really close to my family. I've got a lovely family. But London is, it still feels like it's mine. And it still feels exciting. Like the other day I was doing a show in Brighton. But I had a meeting in Soho and I had like an hour to get to London Bridge for my train. So I like walked through the Strand down over Waterloo Bridge. And you know, the view both sides is great.
That never gets old, does it?
No, that's the thing. And even though it was raining, because it's
London,
it just still felt, I don't know, it feels special. And it feels like the kind of place where anything can happen. And it still feels like a place where you know, I know that we've seen some quite troubling things on in the media lately, and, you know, especially some homophobic stuff and stuff happening in London, which I find especially upsetting.
The bus story.
Yeah, the bus story, but there's, you know, there's horrible stories like that every week, unfortunately. It just happened that one got picked up, you know, and unfortunately it happens a lot more to men. Not a lot more, I don't know that for a fact. What's that? That might be bollocks, but I've seen a lot more stories about that happening to men on public transport. But I refuse to allow to think that sort of bigots own this place. For me, it feels somewhere where it is super inclusive and it is, people are welcome.
Incredibly diverse place.
Yeah,
you walk along the street and you just see a rainbow of just characters.
Yeah, exactly.
Individuals.
And I think that's why London always felt exciting for me, because it felt like a place where people came to sort of be themselves.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
And
without fear of ridicule. And
yeah, and I think that...
You hope.
Yeah, I hope. And I think London still has that, or still has some of that.
More of that.
Yeah. Certainly more than Portsmouth ever felt. And so, yeah, it still feels a bit special to me.
How old were you when you figured out that you were gay?
I was about 4.
Is that something that happens?
Yeah, yeah. Well, for me, yeah.
In like a moment of epiphany? Is it a slow, gradual realisation?
No, I remember noticing a girl's bum in some very tight trousers at school.
Right.
And then realising...
How old were you at that point?
About 13 or 14.
Right, right. And that's kind of when it happens for everyone, whatever your sexuality is, isn't it? I think that's when you
kind
of become...
And I remember seeing boys looking as well and me thinking, oh. Yeah. Literally like, oh, okay. Oh, but I didn't come out until I was nearly 21.
So much later. And after a couple of years in London. So even when you got to London, it wasn't
I had a boyfriend and I was absolutely desperate not to be gay. That's the interesting...
Do you think that's something that a lot of people go through? Is that...
I think so. I think it's becoming less
now. I want to fit in. Let's try and just...
Yeah, I think less now. Like, I know I've got a cousin who is at school and out, and he couldn't give a shit what anyone thinks of him, and he's amazing and inspiring, and he's 15. And then, you know, because of a podcast that I do with Tom Allen,
Like-minded friends,
which
you've been on that for a while. You were like one of the early podcasters just before the big boom.
Yeah, we've been out there for a while, and it's just me and Tom Allen talking about stuff.
Yeah, do you talk a lot about gender politics and sexual identity in there? Or is it more just mates having fun?
A bit. I mean, we're always going to be two gay people hosting it.
Yeah.
So, you know, sometimes it can't help but be a political act, just in the fact that we're being there and we're saying it and we're living our lives in a very open, unashamed way. And certainly because we have listeners in countries where homosexuality is yet to be decriminalised.
Yeah.
Which is
how
mad.
Many is that? How many are there in the world?
71.
Now? 71 still.
Yeah, and punishable by death in 11.
Fuck.
So it's still pretty. Still pretty ropey out there for a lot of LGBT plus people, but it's I don't know. It's I had like a moment where I thought, oh yeah, I am definitely this, but it took me a very long time to not be ashamed of it. And I think that there are some young people, and certainly as I was about to say, that get in touch because of the podcast. I know more about them because they reach out to us a lot and send us lots of emails, which is amazing and lovely, and I always love hearing from them, and they're always so brave. Like, I'm 14 and I'm out at school, and you're like, wow, I can't even imagine being that brave. And so I think that there's certainly more LGBT plus representation in the media, which is really important, but when I was growing up there was much less of that, and I was desperate to be normal. I always think it's a strange thing when people, certainly when homophobic people will think, when people think it's a choice, because it would be such a bizarre choice.
Yeah, to make your life drastically harder.
Yeah, like, you know, my girlfriend and I are engaged, we're thinking about where we're going to go on our honeymoon, and you have to think, we want to go somewhere hot, but it can't be somewhere where we can't be us.
Yeah.
You know, and there's a lot of places where you can't do that. There's countries and there's cities in the UK that I wouldn't hold hands with Alice.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
And that's from going there a lot through touring and getting a read for the local.
Yeah, I mean, only times I ever get heckled is because of my sexuality. I've been shouted at the street. People have spat at me in the street. Like, it happens. Like, you know, we like to...
Is that because you're a recognisable lesbian or...?
I think it's because I'm recognisable as a lesbian, not because of being famous or anything. It's because I have short hair. I don't necessarily... I always have makeup on, but I'm not, I don't necessarily dress hugely femininely. I'm sort of androgynous in how I like to present myself.
So that happens a lot. Does it, people who don't know that you definitely are, but assume that you are, shout horrible stuff at you?
Well, not a lot. A lot would be, I think it happens, you know, there are a lot of other people that
once is too much, right?
Yeah, it happens. And, you know, it's never nice. Or, like, you know, you'll get people giving you dirty looks. Or, you know, that it's impossible to... I don't know. It's difficult because I live in this sort of media bubble of London and all of my friends are very, you know, open-minded and left. Yeah. And you sort of forget
that
there's...
Well, that was what, I guess, the surprise of Brexit for a lot of people, wasn't it? Was people don't think that way.
Yeah,
and
of course.
I'm from Birmingham and I go back to Birmingham all the time and I love Birmingham and that's my home. And there's certainly a very strong working class flag out the window element in a lot of Birmingham suburbs, even though it's got so many people of... you know, different ethnicities and religions living there. There's no real integration in the same way that there is in London. And and my little town, Solihull, was, I think, a massive stronghold for Brexit.
Yeah. And it's really,
But people who don't leave London don't necessarily see that, do they? So they just assume that everyone... And I think the internet's a big part of that as well, isn't it? A lot of people will just delete their school friends who might be, you know, inclined to say racist or homophobic things. So they just think, oh, out of sight, out of mind.
Yeah, and like, I mean... Talking of Birmingham, you know, the diversity is obviously a fantastic thing, but then, like, you know, the no outsiders thing that happened at the Parkfield School that started in Birmingham also happened in other schools. It also wasn't just people that were, you know, following the Islamic faith. It was also Catholic people and people, you know, from all sorts of religion that didn't want their children to be taught that gay people existed. And that became a massive thing. Sort of that I saw from like my friends and my friendship group and people, you know, and with the girls, what we were saying about being attacked on the bus, you know, people go, oh my God, I can't believe people think like this. I can't believe people feel like this. And it's like, yeah, it is, you know, that doesn't, unfortunately, it doesn't surprise me that people were protesting outside of a school to say that children, I don't want my child to know that gay people exist. Because what they are protesting really, what that is really saying is, I hope my kid's not gay. That's what that is.
Openly saying that, isn't it?
Yeah. Openly saying that. And that...
Because there's something inherently wrong with that.
Exactly.
Or evil, even worse.
Yeah, exactly. And that, you know, whilst things are getting better for LGBT people, it's impossible not to see that and feel... You know, imagine if you were 15 and you lived down the road from that school and you had just worked out that you were gay and you just worked out that you fancied, you know, her rather than him or him rather than her. And... you went past that every day, or you saw that in the news every day, you saw your parents talking about that every day.
What that does to a young kid's psyche,
I mean, it's so damaging. It's so, so damaging in a way that I think, I've described this before on podcasts. I'm sorry if anyone's listening, I'm repeating myself, but I felt until I was like, I'm 33 now, same as you, and I feel like until I was about 30, I wore a backpack of shame. Every day it was heavy. Because I was I still held so much shame around my gayness. And I was up on stage, and I was being out, and I was loud, and I was proud about it. But really, I still had quite a lot of internalized homophobia that I was yet to deal with. That I have done so in the last few years, and it all comes down to how I thought about myself as a teenager and how much shame and disgust I felt around my sexuality, because of how much shame and disgust society was telling me to have. And like, you know, you see things getting better, you think, oh, things are better now for gay people or for LGBT plus people, and then you see things like that and you're like, oh no, that's putting some more shame in the backpack of those kids that you know. And so it's still difficult. I think I don't exactly know where the question started, but I know I just kept talking.
There are no questions.
That's fine.
Just
then.
Topics. So, assumedly, you say that you're very close to your family. Assumedly,
yes.
Their response when you came out and told them was nothing but support and love. And
yeah, I think that they were a bit surprised. My mum didn't really know any gay people. She knows lots of them now. she went to the it was Pride in Portsmouth last weekend, and I wasn't home, but she went to sort of stand on the street and clap while the march walked down, which I thought was brilliant. I think my mum had moments of confusion. I think she had created an idea of what my life might look like. she also knew that I was going to experience homophobia, and I don't think any parent wants their child...
I want to protect you from that, yeah.
Yeah, and so my mum did say, is it a phase? Are you sure it's not a phase? You're very young, how could you know? You know, you haven't had many boyfriends, maybe it's that, you know, because she didn't want me to live a life where people might shout at me in the street, or where, you know, I couldn't go to certain places, because everybody wants their kid to have an easy life. Certainly now, you know, she's hugely supportive and is very excited that I'm getting married and is very supportive about
When's
everything.
The date?
It's May next year, so we've got a little
while.
We've got 11 months.
Well, congratulations on the engagement.
Thanks. It's very nice. It's very exciting.
And expensive, right?
Yeah, it's a bit expensive. But it's great. Like, you know, it's still, it's really, it's big because, you know, gay people have only been allowed to get married in the UK since March 2014. It's only been 5 years that I've had the right to be able to be someone that gets married. So it is still a big, yeah, it's still a big thing. And yeah, my family have been very supportive in sort of the grand scheme of things. And certainly my aunts, my uncles, my cousins, and even my nan, who I came out to, she's not with us anymore, but I came out to her when she was about 91, 92, and she was very, okay. I think maybe by the time you've seen a world war and shit go on and you've sort of seen everything, you can sort of be like, yeah, all right, gay people exist, that's fine, I don't mind that I'm related to one of them. But yeah, I think that there's also a suggestion in sort of working class people that they might be, you know, homophobic or racist, but often I found that working class people rub up against more different types of people than anyone else. If you live in a very middle class or even upper class world, the likelihood is you're only ever going to mix with people that are just like you.
Yeah.
Because they're university educated, probably white. Not everyone, obviously, but if you're
of a
certain age.
I think those kind of people as well are less likely to express those opinions, but more likely to have them.
Yeah, I think you're probably right. Yeah.
Because of the air of respectability and keeping up appearances, yeah. You don't show your true colours as much. But I feel like those people are a lot more inclined to be. Like, my mum's bipolar, mm-hmm. and so I grew up with, you know, a very suburban white picket fence community around us, judging my family as, oh, that's the kid with the crazy mum, you know. And that was, you know, something that I was, you know, experiencing from a very young age all the way through my teenage years.
That must have been so hard.
I think
you must have wanted to protect her, but also be...
It's when it's kind of all you know. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
I guess the same thing with you. Like, if it's all you know, that those adversities that you face are obviously challenging.
But it's just your life.
But it's just your life, and it does make you stronger and more sympathetic, I think, towards other people's struggles and
plights.
Yeah,
definitely. Definitely. I'm really... I feel like... You know, sometimes you meet people and, like, you think, you've not had it hard enough.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like when you meet really attractive people and you're like,
yeah.
Oh, you haven't developed a personality.
yeah.
You never needed
one. Because you haven't had to, yeah.
Yeah.
You just stand there.
You never needed to be funny.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm a big believer in that. I think these things make you stronger and better, and if you can survive them, what's scary is when the people who obviously can't and don't, you know, decide that you know, life's too much and they do it. That's what really breaks my heart.
Yeah, absolutely. Also, I think that the more open you are, like I've talked about being someone with anxiety on stage a lot before. My last show was all about that. And you know, the more that the more you talk about that sort of thing, the more people talk to you about being the same. They'll go, oh yeah, me too.
Yeah, massively.
Or you know that when that I'd have people waiting for me every night after the tour, being like, I had a bit in the last show where I talked about the fact that I worry in the middle of the night and I call it my 3 a.m. press conference,
right.
And all the voices in my head meet up to have a chat.
And are you awake at that point?
Yeah. I'm awake.
Yeah.
And I'm going like, North Korea, global warming, we should stop using straws. Did that person look at me funny? Does that person like me? Did I say the wrong thing? I sent that text, it was a joke. I hope they realised it was a joke. Oh God, Donald Trump. Oh God, Brexit. What's going to happen to the country? Blah, blah, blah. Oh, I love this country,
so
but I don't
know.
You
have a super overactive mind and imagination like me.
Yeah. And the amount of people that would come up to me after the show and go, I get 3 a.m. press conferences too.
feel less alone now. I feel better about it.
Well, that's the thing. And that's the thing that I love about stand-up. You know, I never want to be someone that's like, you know, comedy's amazing, guys. It will save your life. But there is something about talking about stuff and normalizing it. And certainly, you know, I find that with my audience. I've got a really mixed audience. Loads of straight people come and see me. Lots of gay people come and see me, you know, and everyone in between and, you know, non-binary people and who, you know, and trans people. Whoever wants to come is so welcome there. And, I don't know, I think just standing on stage and saying, this is how I feel, this is who I am. Even if you're not different in the same way that I'm different, I think it makes people go, oh, well, my differences are also valid.
Yeah, my kooks, what you perceive as your flaws, but actually they're just your idiosyncrasies that define who you are.
Yeah, and there's like, and there's nothing to be ashamed about that. And, you know, I think that's a really big, I don't know, I think shame is the thing that can be really damaging. And I think like just being really open about that sort of stuff, you know, whether it's anxiety or depression or being a member of the LGBT community or, you know, whatever else it is, or being proud of your heritage or whatever it is. I think people stand up on stage and talk about things. I think it's great for everyone because you're hearing a different person's, you know, insight into the world. You're getting a little, you know, a little caption of what they are and what they believe. And yeah, and I think it's just, that's why I love stand-up, because as you say, there's no one else writing it for you. It's unedited. It's just, this is who I am, this is how I feel, this is what I think, and I'm going to make it funny.
Yeah, that's the key, isn't it? And I think what makes a really great stand-up, like the difference between a good and a great, is a good stand-up will kind of talk and express ideas, but a great stand-up will really communicate them to an audience, and they'll really make a connection and engage and change the way that the audience member perhaps thinks, and hopefully make them laugh as well.
Yeah, I think you're right. And I think that you can change people's opinion through laughter. You know, I really think that you can really connect with people. Also, I think I've said this before, but I think laughter is so good for the soul.
Yeah, it is. Well, it's a great form of therapy and healing, isn't
it? Yeah.
As is crying, like.
Yeah.
Has the same.
Sitting in a room, laughing, really laughing at something. You know, it's, whether it's, you know, whether it's in a comedy club or it's with your friends, you know, it's so great. If you get a really good laugh out so much that you feel sort of exhausted by it, you feel great for the next few days. It's so good for you. And that's why I love stand-up. And if I can, you know, I sometimes facilitate that for people. You know, when people will send me messages, you know, on Twitter, I saw Suzi Ruffell's tour last night, I'm still laughing at lunchtime. I'm like, great. That's great.
That's the ultimate reward, right?
Yeah. And it's nice doing the telly, and it's nice, you know, being able to afford, you know.
How different is the telly stuff? Whoa, putting my mic over there.
Okay.
The experience of it. Does it feel more controlled and staged and less unpredictable? And
it depends what you're doing. So I'm not, I'd be the last person to say that I'm like hugely experienced with TV. You know, I've done a fair bit of telly in the last couple of years. Previous to that, I hadn't really done any. When you're doing stand-up on telly, it's less loose because you're sort of working to a script.
Yeah.
And you also need to know that you can't say anything that would be like liable.
Yeah.
And you can't do anything that's, there's certain rude words that you absolutely cannot say.
What are the rude words that you absolutely cannot say on telly?
I don't think you're allowed to say motherfucker or cunt.
They're the two, is it?
I think so,
right.
Yeah. I've said fuck before on telly.
Just not with the mother in front of it.
I don't think you're allowed to say it. But maybe I've just assumed that. I don't know why I think that, but I feel like it's no motherfuckers, no cunts.
Or maybe people can tweet in and find out, so we don't have to Google it.
I'm sure, but I'm sure people will text in and be like, oh, so-and-so did. And so, but I'm sure there's different rules to different people. I'm sure Frankie Boyle has said some terrible things. But
what do you think about that? Can I ask you about that real quick? About people who say things that are very offensive in the context of a joke, and then people who get offended and go, you can't say that. You know, say if someone's making a joke about a topic like rape, let's say.
Yeah, I would. It's not for me. I'm not going to police what anybody says, but I wouldn't be the comedian making that joke. I can only really talk about what I do on stage. I think that a lot of people make jokes. Like, I don't think that anyone's language should be policed. I also just think some things are a bit nasty and grubby, and I think they're a bit of a prick if they do it.
Yeah, yeah.
And I don't like it, and I don't really think it's stand up for me. But I also don't want to live in a society where someone says you can and can't say this.
Yeah.
But
I think that's the thing, isn't it? Is if you don't like that joke or that person, don't go see them.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
But then you shouldn't be going, well, you shouldn't be allowed to say that, because there are people out there who clearly do find that funny. But then it's like, what are the long-term implications of that?
I don't know, it's
a multi-layered argument, isn't it?
Yeah. I think people should be careful. I think, you know, but I can only talk about what it is for me. For me, the idea of upsetting anyone by, you know, saying the wrong thing or being, you know, lazy with my language, using a punchline where I said something, you know, if I, you know, offended anyone, unless I offended someone who was like some homophobic wanker, I'd love to offend you, mate. I hope I offend you for the next fucking, I'll offend you until the cows come.
I'll do a whole special just
Yeah, exactly.
You.
but I really
About someone feeling discluded, right?
Yeah, because I know what that feels like.
Yeah.
I know what it feels like to be discluded. I know what it feels like to feel like your opinion doesn't matter. Yeah. It's really rough. And so I think it's really important that for me, in my stand-up, that it feels like everyone's welcome and no one should be made to feel silly. And, you know, I don't think I'm massively soft on stage, but I'm also not a huge fan of people that take the piss out of the audience. You know, I know some people love it. Some people sit in the front row because they like having the piss stripped out of them. But some people hate it. And I've seen, you know, comics do what I think is quite lazy work, sometimes quite hacky stuff.
On the crowd?
Yeah. Like, you know, two guys in check shirts going, oh, it's a bit broke back. It's like, okay, let's unpack that. Firstly, you're saying these two guys are gay. Then you're saying calling someone gay is an insult.
Yeah.
This is so lazy.
Yeah.
This is bad comedy. That's what that is. And I really dislike that when people just pick on the front row. I think chatting to the front row, I think talking to them, I think if they say something funny, if they put you down a little bit, you can have a playful thing because then they've engaged with you
and
they've gone, I'm game.
Kind of
and you go, great, you're game. Let's play some back and forth. Great. But I think if you just point at someone and say something like nasty, I'm like, oh, fuck you. They've paid to watch you perform and you've like, you get it less so, I think, with people of my generation, certainly the old guard of stand-up. You get it much more with them. And every time I watch it, I just think, write a fucking joke.
Yeah.
Stop getting your gags off what someone's wearing.
Yeah.
It's embarrassing. You're embarrassing yourself. Write a joke. You know, and...
How do you deal with hecklers? Like, if you had some fairly...
I mean, heckling happens so much less than people think it does.
Really?
Thinks it does. Yeah. I mean, I think it might happen...
Do you reckon it happens a lot more at places like the sort of Jonglers where people are there for like a night out and they're drunk and you've got the one person trying to show off and...
Yeah, and like, you know, not so much. No, I never really played Jonglers, but... You know, there was a long period where I was in the clubs every weekend. Now it's much, much less. But, you know, yeah, you'd have people say rude things or you'd, you know, it would always be something homophobic.
Always?
Always.
Never just like you're a woman, it's always you're gay.
Oh, occasionally you're a woman.
But mainly?
But mainly you're gay. And it would always be men.
Yeah.
And then I'd often ask them to stand up and then I'd explain the reasons to the audience why I wouldn't want to have sex with a man like them. And then they'd feel very silly and then they'll never heckle anyone again.
Amazing. So that's just the go-to.
It would always be something about me being gay. And I'd always just be like, right, okay, let me talk to you. What do you do for a job? Okay, and you think that you're so brilliant that I should fancy someone like you. Okay, so let's go through. And then I can be really nice.
And then you make them laugh. Do you ever have that?
Yeah,
and then you win them over?
You make them laugh. And then, you know, there's little tricks that you can do.
Yeah, because ultimately you want to like, shoot them down, but do it in a way that doesn't make you seem mean-spirited.
Yeah,
and
but
bring
if
them
they heckle you, then...
Fair game.
Well, yeah. I mean, I've had that before when someone's heckled me and I've gone, okay, let's do this.
The
and the audience start cheering.
Yeah,
and
yeah,
like,
yeah.
Yeah, tear them apart. It's like a bloodbath.
Yeah.
And, you know, there certainly was a time where I would get a bit of a kick out of being able to take down a heckler.
Yeah.
Now I find it quite boring. Because I'm like, I've prepared stuff that's much better than what I'm going to improvise about you. But, yeah, I mean, it doesn't, it's, you know, I'd only be nasty to someone if they bring that to
me.
Yeah,
yeah.
And then, you know, and it's, you know, 9 times out of 10, the man that heckles you is like the grimmest looking guy who looks like he doesn't take care of himself and is wearing a shirt that doesn't quite fit and has sweat patches. And you're like, you're the guy. You're the guy that's going to turn me back onto men, are you?
Yeah.
And like, you're just, you know, it's a really weird, yeah. But I mean, like, you know, you can imagine the kind of guy that's going to have a problem with a woman saying she's gay. You know, like, it's a strange thing to be angry on behalf of somebody else about. It's very odd. But, yeah. But, you know, sometimes people heckle and they're joining in, and that's a different thing because they're excited and it's fun. And they want to be part of it. And they'll say something and be like, I've done that, or I've been there, or why did you get it? Like, and then you can tell that they're like, oh, okay, this is, you just want to be involved a little bit. And that's all right as well. You know, sometimes it's a bit annoying if you're getting into a bit of material and someone like disrupts your rhythm.
Yeah, of course. Well, because you're trying to keep your mind on track as
well,
aren't
exactly.
You?
But also, you know, some people really like to, they want to have a little moment of chatting to you. Or you might have spoke to them earlier and then you're getting into a bit and they still think that the conversation's happening.
Yeah.
And then you also don't want to be horrible.
That happen loads, yeah.
Because you're like, oh, mate, I'm sort of at work now. But it's very, generally, you know, but I think there's certain people that it happens more for. You know, like, there are certain comics that, I mean, I think people that like quite rough, slightly aggressive stand-up probably not coming to see me.
Which is a good thing, right?
Which is a good thing.
Stay at home.
Because I'm playful.
Yeah.
But it's more like storytelling with jokes at the end. And, you know, you probably won't come to my... If you're on a mixed bill, like, you know, if you're always on a mixed bill with, like, Kevin Bridges and Frankie Boyle, I'd probably be a bit worried.
You've toured with Kevin a lot, right?
I've done a few shows with Kevin. I can't say that. I've toured with him a lot. But I do.
He's hilarious.
He's hilarious. He's also such a nice guy. He's such a lovely man. I really like Kevin. I also think he's a phenomenal comic.
And he was, like, straight out the gate, 18, 19, massive, right?
Annoying. Someone's so naturally good at it.
It's a
like,
Scottish thing,
fuck
I think.
Off, mate.
I do think two of the funniest people on earth are Australians and Scots. They just have some sort of a inbuilt command of language and view of the world, I think, for me, which just makes them naturally more inherently funny.
Kevin is a really special comic, I think. I think he's really, really brilliant comic and a lovely bloke as well, which is really nice. It was really nice when I sort of got to know, not that I know him well at all, when I got to know him a little bit, just like, oh, you're really nice. You're a really nice bloke. And I'm going for a pint with you.
Yeah.
You're really cool. And that's really, and he was, you know, again, someone that I, you know, he wasn't massive. He was like getting really big when I was like an open spot. And then at that time when I was like just watching everyone's special, well, DVDs then before the specials were happening. And I still pretty much watch, you know, I watch a lot of comedy, but I was watching everything. If someone was playing near me, you know, I knew if people were like doing drop-ins at the store or at Banana Cabaret or any of the other clubs, you know, I'd go down after my set. I can remember going and doing like two open mic gigs on a Saturday and then going and watching whoever was closing at the store just to watch, you know, because I just loved all of it. I wanted all of it. And because I think I was quite good at acting. I got into drama school. I was pretty good at it. But when I found stand-up, I was like, oh, I could be good at this. You know, and then I had
apply the tricks and the trades that you learned
from training to act. Yeah, and I had a period where I was like, at the beginning, I was really good. I was better than I sort of should have been. And then I had like a crisis of confidence and I was a bit shit for a bit. And I thought about giving up. And then I really worked hard and I got good again. But it's that, you sort of, like musicians or anyone else, you sort of become obsessed by the craft.
Yeah. And you're looking and trying to absorb as many different styles of performances as possible.
And how do they do that? And, oh, God. And like, you know, and there are club comics that are... that, you know, aren't necessarily famous people, but like I was working a little while ago with Ian Stone, who's been doing stand-up forever, since long before I was doing it, probably like 20 odd years, and he always has new material. He's always talking about stuff that happened like in the papers that day. He's got such a keen, quick brain that you just watch him going, this is like, no one's stopping him down the street, but you're so phenomenal at what you do. You're so brilliant. You're the best at this thing. 20 minutes a night talking about stuff that's happening in a live environment. You're so great. And yeah, I just watching people, you know, watching all types of stand-up.
Well, it gets you inspired, right?
Yeah, totally. And it makes you think,
fuck,
I need
to write.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly. As soon as you start like sort of playing with the big boys, that's why I think part of the reason I got... So at the moment, my show's been kicked into shape quite quickly. Because I'm touring at the minute, Josh Widdicombe is doing a warm-up tour. And he said to me, do you want to come and do 25 minutes? It's every Tuesday we do it together. We're going just around the home counties playing little theatres. He's like, do you want to come and do 25 minutes? You can do new material. I was like, yeah, great. Because then I can go on. I can be like, oh, Josh is doing new stuff. He's working off notes. I'm doing new stuff. I'm working off notes. And, you know, I'm doing new to somebody else's audience who haven't paid to see me. Really makes you up your game really quickly because... You know, if someone's paid to see you, they don't mind watching you.
You feel like you've got them on side already, right?
Yeah. But they don't know that I'm there. I'm like this added bonus. And some people will be like, oh, great, free. And some people will be like, I've paid for the guy from the last leg, so can I have him, please? So...
Do you get those people?
Oh, yeah.
You do?
But you win them round.
Yeah.
It's funny enough, you win them round. It's not,
yeah.
You know.
That's the fun challenge of it as well. It must be, right? Like, I'm going to get you.
Yeah, exactly. And the fun thing for me is like, so since I've been doing this tour with Josh, it's been about 6 weeks. I've written 25 minutes of new stuff that's now cooking on gas that I could do anywhere. But getting that stuff good enough and going on with new, and like, you know, and Josh and I driving to the gig and me going, I was thinking about doing a tag on to this bit, diddler diddler, do you think that's funny? And him being like, yeah, I think that is funny. And then me going on stage, me doing it, him listening in the wings, that bit did work. And all that's what is the really creative part of comedy. You know, once you've written the show, you sort of put it in gear and do the show.
Yeah.
When you're in the stage where you've got enough material that you don't feel you're not shitting yourself, but it's not finished, is when it's really fun.
And the linking of them all together, right, is the subtle finishing touch, isn't it?
Yeah. So at the moment, my show, I don't know if this is interesting to anyone that's not a comedian, my show is like 6 bits, and I write them all out on pieces of paper, and then every preview, I move the bits around. Go, okay, we'll start with that bit, and we'll end with that bit, and we'll put it in, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, the next show will be 2, 3, 1, 5.
Like sequencing an album, like a musician would, trying to find the right journey.
I guess so. But yeah, so it's...
So you're off to Edinburgh August, right?
I am, yeah.
And then your tour is basically throughout October, November, December. Can you tell us anything? Can you give us any insights
well, the tour
into what we're going to be talking
on
about? It's dances like everyone's watching.
Dance like
called?
Everyone's watching, yep. Yeah. It then goes, there's 20 dates in the spring as well.
Oh, wow. And people want tickets, suzyruffell.com?
Yeah. There's dates being added all the time. Basically.
It sounds like a joyous title. So is that an insight into the tone?
The show this year, I mean, it's sort of similar to what we've been discussing over the last 45 minutes is, or maybe the listeners can tell by my voice, I'm happy at the moment, which is a really lovely place to be for me.
Or for anyone, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. As an audience, it's not really ideal for you. Because what you want from a stand-up is for them, for everything to be a bit shit, and then they'll make it really funny.
Yeah.
And so this year's show is about whether you can be funny.
And happy.
And happy.
And do you need to suffer for your art? Like, do you need to be down to be great?
Yeah. But then I'm happy in myself, but then the world seems
to be
on fire.
Yes.
And how much can you ignore that? And how much...
So you definitely feel like you're becoming more political, perhaps, or socio-political.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think there's always... It's, you know, being on stage with a microphone, being a woman, being gay, you know... It's, you sort of can't help but feel like you're being slightly political by just being there.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think I've always been a little bit political. Am I being more political this year? I don't know. Maybe. It's still being written.
Right.
It's still being written. It might change dramatically. But yeah, it's called Dance Like Everyone's Watching because that is a mistake my mum made. You know those signs that say Dance Like No One's Watching?
Yeah.
My mum thought it was Dance Like Everyone's Watching. Which is a great indicator of who she is as a person.
Yeah.
And my whole family.
And it's a great title for a show.
Just show off. Yeah. Everyone in my family is show offs. We're all show offs. And the idea of mum saying dance like nobody's watching, mum was like, why would you do that?
Yeah, makes no sense.
Makes no sense. Pointless. Dance like everyone's. Dance like it's an audition.
Yeah.
And that's what you need to dance like. And so, so that became the title of the show. And it's, I mean, I think a lot of it's quite joyous. And then I'll talk about other stuff that's less joyous.
Less so.
But try and make it joyous. But I think for a long time I've talked on stage about things that have been sort of quite tragic for me, about death or about heartbreak. I had a terrible breakup that I felt like, you know, you have one. I think you get one or two where you...
The last one for me.
Yeah.
It was 2 years ago and it still stings.
Yeah, you build your...
Does it ever end?
Well, I'm very happy
now.
You just
need to find new love, right?
Yeah, I think so.
Until then,
I think I was still a bit broken when I got with my girlfriend Alice. I think I was still a bit bruised by it all.
Yeah.
But she sort of had enough love to be like, that's okay. You can take it slow. And I was really honest with her from the off, being like, I was just coming out of something that was quite hard. You know, it was, you know, quite a few months later, but it hadn't been as long as a year yet. And I also had a breakup that was a very slow, drawn out breaking up, and then we're back together again. Oh, and then we're breaking up.
I see, that's never. Once it's over, it's over.
It's over, yeah, totally. But you learn these things.
Yeah.
And again, that's a little bit about what the show's about as well, is that I've learned about what my idea of love was and what love actually is. And my idea of what my career might look like and what it actually is. My idea of what my home life would look like and what it actually is. And what I've sort of realised in writing the show, and I don't know if I'll say this as bluntly on stage, but what I've realised is the idea of what I wanted isn't actually as good as what the realness is. Like, I thought the love was this like mad roller coaster that was up and down, and like these huge emotions that were where like it felt like drugs and it felt like you were intoxicated all the time. Whereas love is actually you watching a series together, both on your phones next to each other, and it feels really easy. But I remember people saying that to me when I was in previous relationships that were more uncertain, and I remember thinking, God, that sounds really boring.
I had the same thing. I used to work with a guy called Loz at Kerrang Radio, mm-hmm. and he had a wife at the time, still does, and he'd be going on every day at the studio about how what Netflix show he was going to be watching that night. And I was like, man, I hope I never end up the guy that's married, sat at home watching Netflix with my wife, because that sounds like the most boring thing in the world. And I was in my mid-20s when he was saying, and now I'm like, actually, that does sound like quite a nice, peaceful, happy place to be.
And that's the thing. And I think that your idea of what, you know, it's not just sitting at home watching Netflix, it's dinners and it's
creature
out,
comforts,
and it's,
right?
And like going on holiday together and doing really simple, like this, like, I don't know, like yesterday we went and saw our friend that's just had a baby, held a baby for a bit. I was then going to a gig, but I had half an hour to spare. So we were in the car and we pulled over and we just walked around Wandsworth Common to kill 25 minutes. It was so nice.
Was it
so
sunny?
Nice. The sun was out.
There you go.
Brief period where the sun shined for us.
Yeah.
But that's the thing. It becomes so much more about that person and the moments that you
the
have.
The little things, yeah.
Yeah, and I think that that's, I guess that's part of the show as well. It's the thing that I guess it's on my mind because I was writing about that today, about, you know, what you think love is in your 20s to what you know love is in your 30s. And if someone had told, like, I also need to be careful that I don't sound condescending to the 20-year-olds in the room.
There we go.
But certainly for me, you know, it always has to be about you. For me, my idea of what love was, like, you know, the hot and cold, people cheating,
passion.
Like not really trusting them, that all that sort of stuff. You know, Alice could walk into a room and, you know, Cara Delevingne could be in there saying, do you want to go home with me? I know that Alice would be like, oh, that would be lovely, but I better not. I just know that she'd do that, and she knows that I'd do that, you know, and that's the thing that is really comforting.
Suzi, you're a lovely lady. Thank you so much for a wonderful talk.
Secretly, but
And congratulations on all your success. Thanks. And good luck with the tour and getting it into shape. And come on again another time, perhaps in the new year when you've got the round two happening.
Yeah, I'd love to do that. Yeah, I can tell you whether it was funny. Whether I'm still funny when I'm happy. You'll know if I've decided to be miserable.
Yeah, there we go. We can answer these questions there.